So, guys, it's hard to believe it's been more than 7 years now since Arma 3 came out, and it's even harder to believe that it's still one of the most popular tactical shooters. And so today, what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at why that is, and most importantly, we're going to ask the question, where is Arma 4? Well, guys, this is Billy Eat World again, and let's find out. All right, guys, how you going? Welcome to the video. And to kick off, I just want to start by talking to all of you guys out there who maybe still haven't discovered this game. Or maybe you're someone who has given it a go, but you just haven't fallen in love with it yet. There's a lot of people like that because, look, I've got to admit, it can be pretty intimidating. And the main reason for that is there's just so many things you can do in Arma 3 and so many things the game can be, which means it's a game that you kind of have to invest time into just to figure out how it works. And with so many new games coming out all the time, it's hard to justify that. Now, I'm going to get into why it's so complicated in just a sec, but just before we do, and this is going to be hard, but let's try and narrow down the basics of Arma 3. And as you can see on the surface, well, it's a combined arms sandbox shooter playable in first or third person. And look, it's not that realistic, but it's definitely considered to be more of a realistic game than most shooters, and it's definitely a tactical game as well. Also, another thing worth mentioning is that it's developed and published by Bohemia Interactive, an indie studio from the Czech Republic that you might also know from games like DayZ and Vigor. But most importantly, they also produce professional training simulation software in use all around the world by actual military forces. So this studio isn't kidding around. So what does that mean for Arma 3? Well, it means that unlike a lot of other tactical shooters, this isn't going to be just a Project Reality clone. The roots of the Arma franchise and the real virtuality engine it runs on actually date back to even before Project Reality was a thing, to a franchise called Operation Flashpoint. So it's safe to say not only are Bohemia probably one of the most experienced teams making tactical shooters, they come at it from their own unique perspective. So in a nutshell, if you're new to this franchise, and this might be a good or a bad thing, Arma 3 probably isn't going to look or feel like pretty much anything you've ever played before. Now, also I should mention, not only does the studio have a lot of experience, over the last 20 years or so, a loyal community of modders has grown up around the franchise as well. Because unlike a lot of AAA studios, Bohemia has actually continued to support modding over the years, rather than trying to kill it off so that it doesn't affect DLC sales. I mean, for example, there's mod projects in Arma 3 that are almost as old as the franchise itself, and not just that, some of these mods have even gone on to become their own franchises. For example, DayZ started out as a mod for Arma 2, and of course there's also Brendan Green, better known as PlayerUnknown, who built his first Battle Royale mode in Arma as well, which obviously led to PUBG. So, bearing that in mind, you can understand why it's so hard to actually define what Arma 3 is. It can literally be a mil sim, or a Battle Royale game, it could be a vehicle simulator, or it could be a survival horror game. And that's just the multiplayer. The official single-player content can vary massively as well. For example, the East Wind campaign is a fairly linear milsim set in the Greek islands. Whereas 2019's Contact expansion puts the player into a first contact scenario in Eastern Europe, where you literally have to communicate with aliens. And not just that, but in the last year or so, the devs have also released an open world scenario called Old Man, which is basically like a cross between GTA and Far Cry in a tropical island setting. Now, beyond the vanilla content, like I said, one of the main reasons there's so much diversity in this game is because of the community-made content, like mods and scenarios. In fact, with the built-in 3D editor, you can even create your own scenarios with little or no experience, or if you do have some coding experience, you can script more complex missions from scratch as well. For most people, though, that's probably still going to be too time-consuming, which is why probably the most revolutionary feature of Arma 3 is actually something called Zeus. It's basically a 3D editor that can be used in real time in a multiplayer server. And what it does is basically lets a game master create scenarios for other players on the fly. So obviously you can imagine the endless possibilities that opens up. Now, so far in a vacuum, what I've already described, I think is actually probably the closest that we've ever seen to a true open-ended sandbox shooter. But you see, I haven't even scratched the surface of how deep this game can be yet. We're still talking about the macro level stuff here. Because unlike most shooters, which have the same kind of basic feature set and the same kind of basic controls, Arma 3 is the kind of game that attempts to allow the player to do almost anything they want. And if there happens to be something you actually can't do in the vanilla game, well, someone's probably created a mod to allow you to do that as well. And that's where I think a lot of people get turned off by this game. It's a game that literally uses almost all of your keyboard. And not just that, but you've probably picked up on by now that modding is pretty common in this game. And I know some of you guys can be pretty skeptical when I start to mention mods. Because in most games, mods can be unstable and tough to set up. But once again, you've got to remember Bohemia actively encourages mods. They've made it a lot easier to install and run them, especially over the last 7 years. And they've got it to the point where it's so easy that all you have to do is subscribe to mods on the Steam Workshop, load them up in the game launcher itself, and then you can share mod presets with your friends so that they can download them automatically when you want to play in a multiplayer server. Now, even bearing all of that in mind, I wouldn't be surprised if you're actually still a bit confused. And look, that kind of gets back to what I was saying about Arma 3 being so unique. I mean, like I said, it's a large-scale combined arms shooter, but when you compare it with other large-scale combined arms shooters, like Battlefield, for example, it's not even in the same ballpark. Most larger multiplayer shooters, and that even includes games like Squad and Postscriptum and Hell Let Loose, even if they are asymmetrical, they're still designed to be somewhat balanced. And that takes away from the true sandbox experience. The devs literally prevent you from doing everything, because sometimes doing everything is not the best thing for the game. Now, obviously, Arma 3 isn't really as strict on that kind of stuff. And one example is, well, the maps can be like 10 times bigger than your average Battlefield map, which means that sometimes you will be spending a lot of time just traveling from A to B. And that means that you're not going to be in the action all the time. Now, in a Battlefield game, that'd be considered a bad thing. But like I said, Arma is a lot deeper. And it's got a way of turning all of that boring stuff like driving to the objective into something fun. Preparation and planning for a mission is almost like solving a puzzle, and every member of the team has a role to play in that. Sometimes the boring stuff is actually what needs to be done to get the job done. Now, just to unpack that a bit more, the reason stuff like that can be so fun is because, well, one of the main characteristics of Arma 3 is teamwork, which is obviously really important in other tactical shooter games as well, like Squad and Hell Let Loose, but this game, once again, it takes things to just a whole nother level. Like I said, you can do almost anything, but most importantly, you can do stuff like laser designate targets for guided bombs, or you can do stuff like fly transport helis and drop squads into the AO, which is obviously a lot more in depth than what you can do in most so-called team-based shooter games. It's more than just reviving players and giving out ammo. Now, once again, that's also true in some other games like Squad, but one thing I should mention is that most multiplayer shooters have only got a fairly limited set of playable roles. Once again, that's for balancing. Whereas Arma 3 literally has dozens of different kits to choose from just by default, and it's also got a fully fledged inventory system to customize your loadouts even further if you want to do something beyond those roles. Now, to balance that out, the game doesn't prevent you from, say, being a sniper with a rocket launcher, but it does have a stamina system that'll slow you down if you choose to do something crazy like that, which, as you can imagine, does turn into a bit of a clown fiesta on public servers. That gets back to what I was saying before about the game not being entirely realistic. But hey, once again, it's another really great example of why this is a true sandbox game, and it's not like games like Battlefield or Squad. All right, so moving on, another thing I really want to mention is you might have noticed from the gameplay in this video that I'm actually playing co-op mostly in a lot of these clips, and that's because, well, PvE is actually really popular in this game because, like I said, the Zeus feature allows a real human player to spawn in enemies for the other players in real time. But with that being said, though, there are PvP modes as well. Like I said, Battle Royale originally started out in Arma, and there's also a bunch of popular survival modes as well. And there's literally everything else in between. Just take a look on the Steam Workshop, and you'll find an Arma 3 version of pretty much any game mode you could ever want. Now, the question is, though, just say you do find something on the Steam Workshop, how do you actually get in and play it with your friends? Do you need to rent a server? And well, the answer is yes, you can, but you don't have to. You also have the option to play scenarios on your local machine in single player or in multiplayer if you want to open up a hosted server. But with that being said, though, probably the most confusing thing when you first start out, though, is the public server browser. It's not like most games. You're going to see a lot of modes that you've never heard of before, which is obviously really intimidating. But after a while, you'll actually realize that's part of what gets you hooked into this game. There's always something new to try out. Now, so far, we've spent a lot of time talking about the positive aspects of Arma 3, but if you've played this game before, well, you probably know where I'm going next. Admittedly, it has gotten a lot better over the last 7 years, but at the end of the day, it's a gigantic game made by a proportionally small team. It is going to have a lot of bugs. Not just bugs, but really, in my opinion, it's taken 7 years for it to get to the point where the average PC can actually run it at a decent frame rate. And even then, it's still not that great. Most of the time, I can hit a solid 60 frames a second, but depending on how missions are optimized, it can drop well below that sometimes. And that's probably the single biggest reason I think a lot of people try this game out and then never go back to it. These days, people do expect a lot more. But at the end of the day, it's like anything. The more you get used to it, the less important it becomes. And not just that, you'll learn the tweaks to squeeze a few extra frames out as well. Now, there's probably a lot of reasons why this is still a problem. Definitely mission design is a big one, but mainly I think it comes down to the fact the engine is really old. Real virtuality, like I said, in its various forms, has been around for almost 20 years now. And the reality is the devs just don't really have the time and resources that a AAA studio has. In saying that, though, if you know anything about Bohemia Interactive Games, well, you probably have heard that they actually have a new engine now called Infusion, which is actually the engine that DayZ runs on. And probably the most interesting thing is that DayZ didn't actually start out on that engine. It was converted sometime after it came out. Now, I'm not really big into that game, but as far as I know, the switch to the new engine massively improved the performance. So a lot of people over the years have speculated that maybe we might see Arma 3 switched over as well, or more likely Arma 4 will come out running on the new engine whenever the new engine is finished. The thing is, though, we haven't actually seen either of those things yet, and the devs haven't really said anything about the future of Arma either. And so another theory that's gained a bit of popularity in the last few years is that they're just going to keep on releasing DLC for the current game, and we might not see a new Arma game at all. Now, officially, Bohemia have basically stopped releasing any big DLCs for Arma 3, but in saying that, they haven't stopped releasing content altogether. We're still getting the occasional small update, and there's still more officially supported creator content coming as well. So it's not like they're still not making money off DLC. Now, that kind of brings me to the last point I want to make in this video, and probably the most important one. Could it be the reason Arma 3 has lasted so long is also the reason the franchise has stalled? I don't think many people would argue with the fact that this game is probably the most complex tactical shooter ever made. So how does Bohemia top that? Maybe the prospect of releasing an even bigger and better Arma game on a brand new engine is just too big for Bohemia to handle. And most importantly, if tens of thousands of people are still playing it every day, and if mods are still being added every day, then why not just keep milking the current game for all it's worth? Now, that's kind of a depressing thought if you're a veteran player, and we'll have to wait and see if that's actually true. But the good news is, if you're a new player, it means that the current game has still got a lot of value left. Unlike most 7-year-old games, people aren't exiting the game for a new one. And if you can somehow get through the current content, which you won't, there's still plenty of content being added by the community. And like I said, and I'm glad that I'm ending on a positive point, but now is actually probably the best time in terms of performance that you've ever had to get into this game. This isn't your regular run-of-the-mill old game. It hasn't been abandoned by its dev team. It's been massively improved in the last few years, and in a nutshell, and this is the point I want to end on, it's not perfect yet, but it's still getting better, and that's why you should give it a go. But anyway, guys, that just about wraps up this quick review. So thanks, as always, for checking out the video. And please let me know what you think in the comment section down below. And of course, just remember that I can't possibly get every single detail right in videos like this. So if you think that I've missed anything, please put it down below. I'm sure everyone who is looking to buy this game might want to have a read of that as well. As always, though, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. And please feel free to check out the links in the description if you want to see any more of my videos. And also, don't forget you can find my Twitter and Discord links down there as well if you want to keep in touch. And as always, until next time, see you later, and have a good one.